High-profile cyber attacks on hospitals and cities thrust ransomware into the headlines. But it isn't just big institutions that have to contend with their computers being held hostage for money. Joining us now for a primer on ransomware and how Ontarians and businesses can protect themselves, Cheryl Biswas. She is a cybersecurity consultant. And John Shire. He's a senior security expert at Sophos Canada. Nice to have both of you here at TVO tonight about something that I suspect a lot of us know very little about. So let's start at first principles here. What's ransomware?
Sure. Thanks, Steve. So ransomware, very simply, is a piece of malicious software, what we call malware in the business, that installs itself on your computer by a variety of means. What happens then is basically all of your files get encrypted, which means you don't have access to them unless you have the key. The crooks hold the key, they demand payment for that key, and there's where we get the name ransomware.
Cheryl, how does somebody outside get access to the inside of your computer?
Well, they're looking for vulnerabilities, and it's things you may not even be aware of. But operating systems get older, faults are detected, and the ransomware is able to come in via exploits. That means that the bad guys have been very carefully doing reconnaissance, looking at the systems that we take for granted every day, looking for the holes in the code, the stuff we're supposed to be patching. They build the exploit takes in their malware, and that's how they're able to deliver the payload of the ransomware.
All right, payload, let's take a look at this. Can we bring these up, Sheldon? These are some photos of a computer screen that has been infected with ransomware or malware, whatever you're calling it. And what are we looking at here, John? Just basically take us through that.
Yeah, so this is a typical example of something that pops up on your screen. It could either be an actual window pop-up or a wallpaper that gets set on your desktop that describes basically that you've been affected by ransomware. You've
hacked.
Been infected by ransomware.
Infected.
You could use the term hacked as well.
Okay.
And it gives you instructions on how to get your files back. It gives you instructions on how to pay, in what form to pay, so in this case Bitcoin, as we saw, what denominations they're expecting, or what amount they're expecting, and then very often it'll give you some clues as to how to convert your cash into Bitcoins, give you a tutorial on Bitcoins. There's all sorts of things they can include in there, but basically it's your roadmap from infection to getting your files back.
Cheryl, some people may be watching this right now thinking, this has never happened to me, I've never heard of this, why do I need to be worried about this? How often does this happen?
First, cyber criminals are businessmen. They're looking for the most efficient return on investment. Unfortunately, ransomware is a moneymaker. It has been going gangbusters, and it's increased by about 300% since 2015.
While 300% over 1 year?
Over 1 year. We've gone from 29 different variants in 2015 to 79 in 2016, and that we're just not even through the year yet. We know that more is coming, and it's just being able to demand money and create fear.
Now, you say demand money. They actually asked for Bitcoin in that example we just saw.
That's right.
Which is sort of money, but not really money.
No.
Why do they ask for Bitcoin?
Well, it's because it's untraceable. It's a digital currency. It helps them cover their tracks. It keeps them in control of the situation. They can tell you how to get it, but they aren't going to get caught when you pay them in it.
Hmm. And is it only computers that this kind of ransomware can affect?
For the moment, it's basically the Windows operating system. There have been some pieces of malware that affect the Mac OS X operating system as well, and some that infect the Android mobile platform. Hmm. For now, that seems to be the case that of the widely distributed, the most impact is on those three platforms, with Windows being by far the largest share. That doesn't mean that other platforms aren't vulnerable, but for now, that's what we're seeing the criminals infect.
Cheryl just described these criminals as businessmen. Can you tell us, you tell us a little bit more about who does this?
That's hard to say. I mean, we have some clues. If we look at the code itself, the language that it's written in, some of the comments that are included in the code can give us some clues. Some are outright calling themselves out from their geographic locations. If we trace back the command and control servers now, quickly, that's basically where your computer calls home to get that key to encrypt your stuff. Some of those are located in foreign countries. However, even that can be faked. So yes, most of it does appear to be coming from overseas. If we knew the who, I would be glad to be riding in a police car, you know, knocking on people's doors, because these guys, as Cheryl said, are making incredible amounts of money.
So no matter how impressive your cybersecurity is it fair to say these guys are always sort of one step ahead?
They have the advantage of time and money. We're always in a catch-up position.
Right.
So they sit there, they do the recon, they're completely motivated, and they don't have day jobs like we do. So
this is their day job.
This is their day job.
Yeah,
okay.
Exactly.
Let's put this up here. This is from the Canadian Cyber Incident Response Center, which said that in 2015, ransomware accounted for 12.5% of malware attacks. In 2016, that rose to 22%. Okay, that's a percentage increase. What kind of, I mean, in terms of just pure numbers, how often does this happen?
So I'm familiar with those numbers. We actually do some work with Public Safety Canada, and there's some really great people working at the CCIRC trying to stop this kind of stuff from impacting Canadians. Now, the 2015 numbers were basically based on some 30 million or so samples. That's just what CCIRC caught. That's not the totality of all malware out there.
See.
So we're talking volumes that are just orders of magnitude beyond what most of us can possibly imagine in terms of the unique samples.
So is this is happening, what, thousands of times, tens of thousands of times, hundreds of thousands of times?
There have been some estimates that it's about 100,000 victims per week globally, of which, unfortunately, Canadians are just part of that number.
Huh. Why is it increasing so much?
Again, because now that they know how to do it, they can develop the code. And we've watched the evolution of malware into ransomware, and now we've watched the evolution of ransomware through this year. And they found a way to really hold our data hostage, but now to come after our systems. Those were the attacks on the hospitals.
Right. We'll get to that in a second. But what about personal emails? Do they get into that too?
What they get into is, it's phishing. It's by sending you a targeted email, something that you would be more tempted to click on, and it has evolved there very, very much. It's no longer just, we used to call it a spray and pray, where they would do a mass campaign, but they know who their targets are, they know the language of the country, they've worked very hard to improve their grammar and their syntax, so what you open may very well look like it came from Canada Post, you click, and there, you've launched it.
And there they go.
Yeah.
If this is a business, and you can make money at this business, is there any way to figure out or determine what a typical annual income would be for somebody who does this kind of hacking?
There are some ways, but it's very difficult. So as Cheryl was saying, using Bitcoin is highly anonymous, and it's difficult to trace. And they've got certain strategies that they can use to hide the money trail. If we sort of scroll back the clock to 5 years ago, they used to accept payment in Visa, MasterCard, American Express, using credit cards. But they had to pose as legitimate retailers to get a merchant account, and it was more traceable. Now they're openly criminal. They're using Bitcoin. So what we rely on now is doing studies where we can say, all right, how many people were infected, how many people likely paid, what was the average amount that they paid, and then we can kind of do some arithmetic and figure out what those numbers are. Some of that has been done. One particular very profitable piece of ransomware called CryptoWall allegedly took in $325 million in 2015.
In 1 year?
In 1 year. The FBI is calling about $1 billion of damage to, or I shouldn't say damage, but $1 billion of revenue, again, if we can use that term, for ransomware in 2016.
Now, you mentioned Canada Post, but of course, I presume many high-profile institutions in our society could be hit by this. Credit card companies, you know, whatever, banks, everything, right?
Absolutely, anybody can be, it can be, it's a masquerade, so anybody, any business can be hit, any individual can be fooled.
Have any of these hackers been successfully prosecuted?
Specifically for ransomware, none that I know of that have been caught because of ransomware. There was one high-profile takedown, which was the CryptoLocker gang, which was basically arguably the first crypto ransomware variant that we saw come on the scene in about 2013.
What does that mean? Crypto ransomware variant? What does that mean?
So crypto ransomware, meaning the type of ransomware, crypto meaning encrypted or encrypting your files. Okay. There are other types of ransomware, some that just lock your screen, for example, but don't scramble your files.
Got it.
And those guys were caught as part of another takedown for a botnet. And they just happened to find the servers of the private key servers of CryptoLocker right next to the zero access botnet. So they were able to figure out who some of those people are, but not directly as far as I know.
Now, I guess if you watch the movies about this, the assumption is that these kinds of hackers are going to go after huge, important installations like military or government or that kind of thing. But we have seen, including in Canada, they've gone after hospitals. I mean, the Ottawa Hospital, the Norfolk General Hospital, they both got targeted. Mm-hmm. Why this apparent change of target to so-called soft targets?
Well, this past March, there was the attack on the Hollywood Hospital. That was through a different attack vector. They didn't use phishing. They found and exploited a server vulnerability. And that was a wake-up call to our entire community, because once the attackers had found that way in and were able to hold systems hostage, they could ask for a lot more money.
But why hack into a hospital? What have they got?
They have... There's no honor among thieves. And the line in the sand has been crossed, essentially. They don't play by the same rules that we do. They're looking for a cash grab. And there's a much bigger payday in an institution than there is with an individual. So we are very carefully watching the industrial Internet of Things. We are watching critical infrastructure systems, the power grid, water, gas and electric. All of these run on systems that can be just as vulnerable to this kind of an attack.
John, what's your view on why hospitals might be targeted?
I think, you know, if you look at how the initial distribution mechanism works, where it is fairly varied and opportunistic, once you realize that you have a target, a softer target, like a hospital, for example, then you might change your tactic a little bit. You might go, okay, we've got this more valuable target, let's turn up the heat a little bit. The motives and the ways of entry do vary from these different examples that you mentioned, but there is an opportunity for the criminals to get a little bit more money than their typical ransom demand would be to just a regular user on the street.
Well, let's do another example here. Back in June, University of Calgary apparently was hacked, lost access to its email system, and paid $20,000 to reacquire access to what was theirs.
Right.
Should they have paid?
That's a difficult question for me or any of us to answer, really, because we aren't the University of Calgary. We don't know their situation. We don't really know exactly the technical situation they were in as well. Most businesses are pretty resilient against this attack because they will have backups. They will have other systems that can that contain that data or can help, you know, mitigate this kind of stuff. The University of Calgary had a really tough decision to make, and in their case, this was the right decision for them. So it's hard for us to judge them on that simple fact.
Well, fair enough. But Cheryl, let's compare it to, admittedly, this is a bit dramatic, but let's compare it to a hostage situation. I mean, there is a general agreement in international affairs. You don't pay to have hostages returned because all it does is encourage and help fund further kidnappings. Mm-hmm. Is that the same attitude in this world?
That's the stance within the security community. The problem is that we encourage them every dollar we pay them. They know that, and it's kind of like having us over a barrel. It's a very hard call to make. I wouldn't want to have been in the position of the hospital administrators, because what are you going to do to get those systems back online fast?
So you're not prepared to put a blanket condemnation on anybody who pays to get reacquire access to their files?
Again, I can't judge somebody based on that. I've seen the level of fear and I've seen the destruction.
If you're a small business and this means that your livelihood is now over because of this attack, mm-hmm. that you're putting people on the street because they no longer have a job because you can't afford to pay them anymore, it's really difficult for us to condemn them for paying $500 to the crooks.
Okay, fair enough. Let's say you pay the $500. Is there honor among thieves? Do you actually get your files back?
So this is, again, where the term business comes in, right? yes, for the most part, you do get your files back. That is the word on the street is, if you pay these guys, you get your files back. That's good business practice. There's some loyalty there to their customers, if you will. And so, yeah, if you do pay these guys, they will give you your files back, or at least they'll give you the decryption key. There have been some instances where that has not happened. There have been some instances where they've ratcheted up the amount, and if you take too long to pay, they'll sometimes double it. But for the most part, you do get your files back.
How about the other way around? Do hackers ever go easy on people who have a tough time paying?
There have been a few instances of this. There was one where it was, I think, a puppy shelter where they the lady said, hey, I'm trying to pay you guys and I can't, for various reasons, timing reasons and all that, she couldn't get the money in time for the 24-hour grace period. And so the crooks basically at that point said, okay, fine, pay us what you can and we'll forgive the overage, if you will. So there have been instances of that as well where there's some compassion being shown.
We're smiling here, but this is actually, I mean, it's very bizarre. It's almost as if hackers are interested in providing good customer service here. Does it sound like that?
Well, one of the ironies is that they do actually have phone-in helplines, and from what I've heard, they operate better than conventional helplines in terms of customer
service. Wait a second. They have phone-in helplines to help people pay them to get reacquired access to their files.
As crazy as that sounds.
Really?
Yes, they do, because they want to get their money, and they want to make sure you know how to get it to them.
Do you have any advice for a typical business? You mentioned a small business. Do you have any advice for them on whether to pay or not to pay, or what to do, or any of that?
Well, if we put some of the critical controls in place to mitigate this in the first place, to prevent this from happening, then that hopefully takes away the argument of should I pay because you don't get infected. So one of the first things you need to do is you need to ensure that all of your critical data is backed up.
And backed up means what, on a separate hard drive?
That means on a separate medium of any kind, but it has to be disconnected from your network.
So we
use the term offline backup, meaning...
So it could be in the cloud, could be in a hard
drive. It could be in the cloud,
whatever.
But the real key point here is that your existing network should not have access to it, because some of these ransomware modules do actually look for connected devices and will encrypt the backups as well. So that's one thing. The other thing is also to use proactive security measures, anti-malware technologies, anti-exploit technologies.
Does that stuff really work?
It does work, and it is available. And that's why we say backup as well, right? Because not everything in the security world is 100%. If you do those two things, I think you're in a much better position to not have to pay.
Any other advice on how people can protect themselves?
Well, actually, I was going to jump on this one. 3-2-1 backups. So to have 3 backups, 2 different media sources, making sure one of them is offline. Mm-hmm. Because they will find anything that's connected. So any peripherals you have, your USB drives, any additional unmapped network drives, the ransomware will just traverse through and find its way. So whatever is connected will also be corrupted.
So putting it on a separate key.
Physically distance.
Memory stick doesn't work. That's not enough.
If it's connected in, then it will have been corrupted.
Oh my goodness.
Yeah.
Okay.
So just being careful. I would like to say, think before you click.
That's right. Let's read this from The Atlantic. Here we go. Sheldon, you want to put this graphic up? Thanks. The recent explosion of ransomware will not only continue as more everyday objects are connected to the Internet. Newcomers to the Internet of Things are likely to have weaker security systems than computers or servers, which for decades have been designed to weather online attacks. As manufacturers crank out new connected devices, a high priority on functionality can drive them to cut security corners in the name of convenience. Cheryl, this Internet of Things, what is that?
That's all of the wonderful stuff we like to play with every day. It's the stuff that connects online. It's Barbie who connects online. It's our smartphones, smart fridges, smart televisions, our smart homes, thermostats, cars. It's in places now where you wouldn't even think to look, because the desire is for everything to connect.
Can they get malware into the computer that runs your car?
Yes, they can.
But it's not hooked up to anything.
It's receiving, if you've got a Wi-Fi signal, if you've got radio waves, you can connect. And then you can hack a car.
Yikes.
Thankfully, though, specifically with the Internet of Things, a lot of the hacks that I've seen require physical access to these devices. So for now, it seems like this is something where we're kind of living on borrowed time, probably, because hackers have demonstrated that you can modify a device, make it do what you want it to do. I saw an example of a thermostat being ransomed, if you will. at DEF CON this year. And so, yeah, it's one of these things that it's the new frontier, if you will, because there's, I believe the numbers are like 20 billion devices expected to be coming online in the age of the Internet of Things in the next few years. So it is a big market for these.
DEF CON criminals. Sounds like some kind of fancy convention. What is that?
It is, yes. It's basically the hacker conference that occurs every year in August in Las Vegas, where it's nice and cool.
Got it. And in our last 30 seconds here, just from the way you have described this today, this is only going to get worse, I assume. Is that right?
It doesn't seem to be abating anytime soon. We've heard the stats of it coming up, in terms of the money and the variants that are coming out there. So, yeah, it's like basically a popular burger joint, if you will. Once McDonald's exploded in popularity, then you had Wendy's and Burger King and, more Harvey's and all those, some more to come. Yeah.
Yikes. Okay, thanks you two for the heads up on this. Much appreciated. Cheryl Biswas, John Shire.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Help TVO create a better world through the power of learning. Visit TVO.org and make a tax-deductible donation today.